want to be alone, and somebody just comes and they sit down next to me, sat down next to me, started talking to me. And it turned out he had terminal cancer, and he lived in Oregon, and he had never, ever, he had worked so hard all of his life that he never, ever looked around at what was around him in this country. And he said in the last month of his life, what he really wanted to do was to go and just talk to a lot of people. And he wanted to see a lot of things. And we spent an incredible hour just talking back and forth. And I remember walking out to the car and not looking back, because I knew that I would never see this man again. Chances are he will not live out the year. But in 1 hour's time, he made an incredible impact in my life. An incredible impact in my life. And who knows how many of you are going to have that same opportunity in your lives. Who knows what possibilities you've got? So let me see a show of hands of all those people in the room that do not believe that what this person said, that she was the most important person she knew. Do not believe that that's a conceited statement. Show of hands. Come on. Sport. Broke down the bathroom door. This 14-year-old boy hung himself in the shower, and there was a note on the outside of the door that said, "But you didn't like me anyway." going to stop. Let me show you something. What's your absolute favorite car in the entire world? You got a favorite car? Tell me about it. What is it? Was it? A Touran? Or Toyota? What? Describe it to me. Color. Black Toyota. Okay, interior? Red interior. Okay, you get up in here. Absolute favorite car in the world. No, don't turn around, you. Porsche, describe it to me. Color, interior, okay.
Told me something her grandmother had
point was never driven home clearer to me than 5 years ago when I worked in the earthquake area in Italy. And I went over there, not really being sure what to expect. And when I got there, I couldn't believe that everything for 100 square miles was absolutely devastating. Homes, cars, everything was just, just gone in rubble. Sometimes you see a beautiful wood door that would be the only thing standing. And I started to attend a lot of community meetings, and I found the people that wanted to stay there, because their friends were there, and because it was an incredible setting in the mountains. It was just a beautiful place to be. And they decided they wanted to stay there because they felt a sense of the community. They felt that they really cared, they were cared for. That when somebody was sick, the community cared. And the people who were going to get up and take off were usually the people who were attached to all the things that they had rather than the people in their lives. When I was in Vietnam, we used to measure time in minutes, and hours, not in days, months, and years. Because we never knew whether we were going to get up the next day. And so they asked all of you a question. And I would make you a wager on this. If you can answer this question, I will buy you dinner any place in the world of your choice. But as part of a just situation, if you can't answer this question, there's an incredible restaurant in Tokyo that I would like to go back to, at your expense. How do you know that you don't only have 6 months to live? Up and open up and share. Most people don't even know who they are. not the persons who share it, but the people who will listen. We're so busy working off the image. If you're an athlete, do you want people just to remember you for being an athlete? I think not. You drive a decent car, do you want people to remember you for the car? I think not. Spend a lot of time and energy buying things so that people will be impressed enough with us so they'll like us for the things rather than the people who we are. Anybody have a dollar? The odds are in this room, if we went around the room, some of you would know one, two, maybe a couple more people who were really fulfilled in their lives. Based on the odds of the people that you knew that were fulfilled in their lives and the people who you knew, chances are no more than 5 or 10 of you in this entire audience will ever reach that. Incredible girlfriend and a wonderful family life. No one has these answers. No one has the answers. When are some of you going to start feeling better about yourselves and stop being pulled in all kinds of different directions by different people?
Accepted, ran out and bought blue sweaters.
accept it. Buy a brown sweater. Little trite example, but unfortunately, where many of you are in terms of acceptance. So busy asking to be cared for at any price. And again, the question is, do you want people to care for you as who you are, or as the image you project? You see, most people spend their lives keeping people away because it's too painful to let somebody get close, and that's the very thing that we all want. So we keep the image up. What was red and white at the beginning in terms of my own introduction is just my accomplishments, not who I am. What I do here now is very painful to me. I changed schools 5 times between grade school and high school, and every time it was like a whole new experience for me, and I was incredibly shy to start off with. And each time, the hole got deeper. Each time I felt more and more insecure. Each time I felt shyer and shyer. So what I do here is exceedingly difficult for me. Some of you have seen me sitting out in the car before I even walked into the school. I had my head down because every day I get up, it's more and more difficult for me. And every day I keep promising myself, I keep saying, why put yourself through this fear and this pain? Because I keep challenging a fear. And in order to do something that I love to do, I've got to get up and keep challenging that fear. So if you only knew me from the introduction, you wouldn't know me at all. And some of you in this school, people only know you because you're an athlete. Or people only know you because your grades are decent. Or people only know you because of clubs you belong to. And it's real interesting, everybody wants someone in their lives to care. Everyone wants someone in their life to look at them and say, I care about you, I accept you for who you are, and I will be there as a friend, or I will be there as somebody that loves you. This particular part of the talk has been the best part of the talk. You own it. I have seen incredible courage in other schools at this part of the talk, where students are asked to come to the mic to share one good thing that they feel about themselves, or one person in the audience they want to thank for helping them through an issue in their life. Or something that they're going through that they need support in the school. Or some pain that they just need to get out. Yesterday at Sturgis, they had 2 sessions. They both went on for 2 hours. Could have gone on longer. Student got up yesterday and said, I have a learning disability. People have always made fun of me in the halls and in my classes. But there were a couple of people that really Five people jumped out of the audience to hug her. At Menden High School, there was a student with an acceptable head. If you've ever seen that, they're in a large head. And pencil-thin arms, which probably no more than maybe 3.5 feet tall. And he got up and he said, I know that people are going to be looking at me all my life. I know people are going to be staring at me. But I want all of you to know that I'm no more different than any of you. And I bleed inside, I have feelings. And I want friends, and I need friends. Ten people jumped out of the audience and hugged him. He came back to the mic to share that this was the first time in school that people had looked at him. People had actually looked at him as a person, but they hadn't walked past or put their head down. At a high school near Lansing, captain of the football team reached into his pocket, pulled out a knife, stood at the mic with a knife up to his throat. He said, this is where I was last Saturday night. And if it wasn't for my friend Tony in the audience, I'm sure I'd be gone. And Tony rushes out. And they were crying. And they just held each other. That's a friendship that will have that bond for the rest of their lives. No matter where they go, no matter what happens, they will have that bond for the rest of their lives. How many of you in this room have somebody that you want to share something with? Somebody that maybe you've hurt that you want to apologize to, somebody that you want to thank. I want to tell you a quick story. My father was 74 years old and never told me he loved me. Last winter, I had two heart attacks, and I was concerned about the fact that I'd be kneeling before his casket and whispering to him, Dad, I want to tell you that I love you very much and that I'm real grateful that you stood by me. And I decided to take a risk. I had a talk in New York City and I was going to meet my father for lunch. And I was scared to death, that he, because he was a non-emotional man, if I shared with him what my feelings were inside, then he was going to say, gee, thanks, son, I appreciate that. That was really nice of you. And then walk away just crushed. Anyway, I walked around the block a half a dozen times just to get the courage of him. And I got there 10 minutes late. And my father, who's a very rigid man, very structured, who only gives himself an hour for lunch, started telling me, why are you late? You know I only have an hour for lunch. Why do you come late? Why can't you be on time? And I started to cringe in my seat. And I started to say, hey, listen, I'm not going to tell this man anything today. And I went to turn to him and I think, well, I'll take another shot at it. And I saw my father cry for the first time in my life. And I just reached over and I hugged him. And we stood there, both of us, just tears streaming down our face. It ranks at the top of the most beautiful moment in my whole life. And it never would have happened if I hadn't taken the first step. Because you see, if I was waiting for my father to take the first step, never would have happened. So I'm asking some of you to take some courage. I'm asking some of you to stand up and share some things. But first, before that, I'll start it off. It's a real injustice if I ask you and I can't. So I'm really grateful that I have an opportunity to overcome some fears and insecurities by being able to get up in front of you and share really who I am as a person, rather than just the image of the introduction. What's very key to all of this is the people who stand up. Share. And every one of you support those people. Every one of you support those people. Do not let a person come to this mic without at least some of you or any of you or as many of you as choose to do that, support the person. Because the first time I ever did this, which is 2 years ago, at a high school in Detroit, a girl got up and she said, "I feel good that maybe someday I'm going to be a great singer." And everyone in the room laughed at her. I can't tell.